announcing the arrival of Yang Berhormat Datuk Seri Mustapa Mohamed, Minister of International Trade and Industry.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Salam sejahtera, salam satu Malaysia. Very good afternoon. Saudara pengacara majlis yang berhormat Dato' Hamim Samuri Timbalan Menteri MITI, yang bahagia Dato' KSU, Tan Sri Tan Sri, Dato' tuan-tuan dan puan-puan sekalian. The program this afternoon is as follows. I will go through a short PowerPoint presentation, and I'll be releasing to the media two documents. One is a short statement in English, and another a more detailed elaboration in Bahasa Malaysia. Those of you who want to know a little bit more, of course you've got to do the translation, but the contents of the auto policy are contained in my PowerPoint presentation, as well as in English version of the press statement, and the more detailed version is in Bahasa Malaysia. So ladies and gentlemen, let me begin by sharing with you some background information. Many of you are experts. You are not trying to give you a lecture, but I think for those of you not too familiar with this subject, it's useful to start with some background information. Firstly, the global auto industry, as you know, China is now number one. China, in terms of total industry volume, 2013 was about 22 million cars, with a growth of 13.8%. US, as you know, there was a big recovery in US last year. In China, this is a very important industry. In US, a very important industry. Japan, of course, is a very important industry. Brazil as well. Yeah, India is coming up. So the total TIV last year globally was 82.8 million, yeah, compared to 79.5 million in 2012, a growth of 4.2%. So the auto industry globally grew by quite a healthy percentage in the year 2013. Next, we look at our region, which is ASEAN and Malaysia. We can see a similar growth in Indonesia, double digit, from 1.1 million units in 2012 to 1.2 million units in 2013. Thailand, of course, as a result of the November. This is minus 2 months. Huh? So the Thai number is more than 1.4 million. We haven't got the full numbers yet. But for Malaysia, there's been about a 4% increase, 3.94% increase. I'm not too sure whether MA has come up with the numbers. Have you? Not yet. Not yet. This is an estimate: 652,120. Compared with 627,753 in 2012. So there's been some growth, and Indonesia, of course, growth has been very rapid in Indonesia. In graphic form, yeah, you can see a trend in Malaysia. 2011, it came down. It's because of the problems, the economic problems we had, and a few other countries throughout the world had. But there was a strong recovery in 2012, and this continued, the recovery continued in 2013. Next, in terms of investments, yeah, we are pleased to report that investments in the auto sector continues to do well, from 2.3 billion in 2010 to 3.3 billion 2011 and 2012, it went up to 5 billion. We're cleaning up numbers for 2013. At this point of time, we have 3 billion until October 2013. So it's been ups and downs, but quite healthy in terms of quantum. Investments in the auto sector has been quite healthy. Trade performance, yeah. Next, you can see you look at total there at the bottom. Exports amounted to 5.3 billion 2012, and imports amounted to 21.8 billion in 2012. Yeah. There is an imbalance of about 16.5 billion in 2012. The numbers for the whole of 2013 will be out in a few weeks' time. Yeah? and we'll be sharing with you those numbers. We believe 2013 there's been some increase in terms of especially in terms of parts and components. You can see there, let me go on, one by one. Exports, less than 1 billion. We have been exporting less than 1 billion worth of cars. These are passenger cars. On the other hand, imports are a lot more, 9 billion. This year we believe it's somewhere around 10 billion. And then commercial vehicles, similar trend there. Not much in terms of exports, a lot more in terms of imports. Motorcycles, similar situation. Parts and components, this is the area that we are focusing on, one of the areas focusing on the national auto policy. You can see there's been a big increase 2012 from 2.5 billion to 4.3 billion in terms of components, but imports went up as well from 5.4 to 7.6 billion. So total 5.3 billion exports, most of it in the form of components, and imports amounting to 21.8 billion. So this is our trade performance. Next, in terms of some numbers, to show you how important this industry is, according to industry players, after having consulted them with them, we know that in manufacturing, in the auto sector, which is components and cars and assembly and manufacture, manufacturing vendors as well, about 250,000 people are involved in this industry. And after market, there will be sales, service, workshops, and 300,000. In our view, in our estimate, about 550,000 people are dependent on this industry. So this is a very important sector. It is not only in America or in China or in Japan that the auto sector is important. In Malaysia, it is important as well. We've got 11 car companies. We've got 9 companies producing motorcycles. We've got about 500 vendors. After market businesses, this is sales and service, all kinds of businesses, 35,000. So these are companies which are involved in the auto sector, and GDP is somewhere around 3.4-3.5%. Okay, next will be what we call the motorization level per 1,000 people. You can see that among ASEAN countries, Malaysia is the highest, number 5, 361. For every 1,000 people, we've got 361. This is motor vehicles or passenger cars, Marani?
Passenger cars.
So for every 1,000 people in Malaysia, we got 361 cars. In Vietnam, it's only 13. Indonesia, 21. Philippines, 30. Thailand, 157. So there's a big gap between Malaysia and Thailand. So some people say our market is saturated. And that's one reason why the market has not been growing as fast as Indonesia. Indonesia is at 21 for every 1,000 people. There's only 21 cars, but in Malaysia it's 361. That's one reason why Indonesia is growing. So Indonesia is 240 million people. We are only 28 million people. So that's why Indonesia in the last few years, growth has been double digit. Okay. Next, this sector, like many other sectors, have been opened up. This is in line with trends throughout the world. To sign free trade agreements for us. Of course, what's important is ASEAN after 2010, when cars, CBU cars imported from ASEAN enter Malaysia duty-free. There are no import duties. So that was 2010. And we have signed with Japan, with Australia and a few other countries. And all these, some of these, not all, some of these FTAs contain provisions on cars, which I'll share with you in the next few minutes. So this is the reality. Markets are being opened up, being liberalized in Malaysia and many other countries. That's the trend. That's been a trend in the last few years. Okay, I'm just sharing with you next slide. This is I'm taking as examples Australia and Japan. For example, with Australia, CKD now can, because of the free trade agreement, enter Malaysia duty-free. CKD, these are completely knocked down parts, can enter Malaysia duty-free. CBU, of course, Australia is not producing that many cars. This year, it's going to be 10%. Any car imported from Australia will attract a duty of 10%. But 2016, zero. So that's the reality. So there was a time when MFN was 30%, the import duty on cars was 30%, in the last few years it's been coming down gradually. This is known to industry players. Yeah? And 2016 for cars imported from Australia, import duty will be zero. With Japan, this is very important. CKD is already, I mean, no import duties to be paid on CKDs from Japan, yeah, on all segments. But CBU, last year it was 13.6%. This year it's going to be 9.1%. But 2016, cars imported from Japan will attract no more import duty, similar to the situation of cars coming from Thailand. Thailand, 1/1/2010, CBU imported into Malaysia, enters Malaysia duty-free. 2016, cars coming from Japan will come to this country duty-free, no import duties. So this is, of course, creating pressure and competition, of course, is more intense now compared to the previous situation, say 20, 30 years ago, when there's been a lot of protection given to the local auto industry. Let me next share with you, yeah, this is, I mean, these are national cars, yeah, Proton, there's been over the years lots of changes in ownership and shareholding, and now is DRB Highcom. Yes, it's true, Proton, government helped Proton in the beginning, 400 million, that was seed money fully paid, yeah, that was help given by the government of Malaysia. Proton has invested 18 billion ringgit, yeah, new investments, yeah, since then, 3.8 billion, employing about 13,500 people, vendors, Produa, yeah, UMW, yeah, PMB, MBM, DMC, yeah. So these that's a shareholding structure. This is Proton sales or manufacturing. That's Produa, yeah. This is the holding company. Holding company. So Produa has invested from 4.6 billion until 2012, and we expect Produa to invest another 2.4 billion. 10,000 employment and vendors 180. Of course, some of these are common to Proton, Produa, and indeed some other car companies as well. Yeah? Okay, there was a time when they used to come to MITI. I mean, MITI control prices until 2004. All car companies have got to come to MITI for approval. That's no longer that has been abolished in 2004. That's one of the ways in which we protected Proton, yeah, where all car companies will have to come to MITI for approval when it comes to car prices. But that was abolished 10 years ago. Okay. Next. Okay. The policy that I am about to announce is mainly it has got to do mainly with the opening up of the EV sector. As you know, we have frozen ML manufacturing license for 1.8 liters and below. So this policy is to open up the whole Malaysian car market to the EV segment. Before this, you know, no license was given. If you want to come to Malaysia, want to produce a car 1300cc, for example, we say no. Yeah. But now under the EV policy, the ML is going to be given, going to be approved. Yeah, two companies which come here to set up operations in the EV segment. So the EV segment is going to be opened up. Yeah, so these are, I mean, before we go into the EV, let me share with you what has been done in Thailand. In Thailand, they've got what they call the eco car. Yeah, these are definitions given to what is an eco car in terms of fuel efficiency, in terms of carbon emission. The definitions are quite standard. Quite similar in many countries, but in the case of Thailand, it is not open to all segments. It's open only to these segments, which is 1.3 to 1.4 liters or smaller. These are compact or small cars. Phase two is 1.3 and 1.5. Okay, so but for Malaysia, all segments. Yeah, for Thailand, the present policy on eco cars only covers 1.3 for petrol liters and 1.4 liters for diesel based. Emission standard, Euro 4, Euro 5, yeah, safety regulations. And so this is the policy in Thailand, the eco car policy. This car is doing, I mean, there's been production is coming up. There's been a fair bit of investments in this segment in Thailand. Okay, next. This is in terms of investments. There's also another criteria in Thailand. It's got to be at least 500 million ringgit, yeah, phase one. And you need to produce at least 100,000 units. to qualify to get incentives under the Eco Car program in Thailand. Investments have got to be no less than 510 million ringgit. And you need to produce at least 100,000 units, and you're given tax incentives, excise tax incentives, 30% normal and 70% for lower excise duty for Eco Car. So next. Okay, next. What have you got? Okay, Indonesia has got what they call the Green Car Program. There's a definition, and the target is for petrol 1 to 1.2 liters, for diesel 1 to 1.5. So the point I'm making here is that Indonesia has got a program, Thailand has also a similar program, but it's limited. There's some restrictions in terms of investment, in terms of number of units, but in Malaysia we do not impose any, there are no conditions. Of course, the technical conditions are there, but in terms of investment, in terms of units, there's no cap, there's no condition in Malaysia under our EV program. Okay. Next, as I said, we have been in this for 18 months. Yeah, many of you in this room have been with me. I had my last engagement about 5 days ago. That was with Dato Aisha. Yeah, that was my last engagement, and I've been doing this for the last 18 months. Yeah, I had one big one end of last year, and my people have been having engagements as well, and we've been meeting the media. In our view, we have done our best in terms of getting views from various stakeholders. So this policy has been developed, has been conceived after having very extensive consultation with various stakeholders, 18 months, involving OEMs, involving components association, involving aftermarket associations, ministries agencies, involving universities, banks, NGOs, bloggers, social media. For that reason, once again, I would like to thank you for all the inputs and support you have given to this process of engagement. Okay, I want to go to specifics now. What are the objectives of NAP 2014? One is to promote a competitive and sustainable domestic auto industry, including the national car companies. Competitive and sustainable. Number two, this is very important, probably the most important. Probably number two should be number one. To make Malaysia as a regional automotive hub in energy efficient vehicles. As I said, we have this in Thailand, parts of this program in Indonesia as well, but we believe ours is comprehensive. So that is objective number one, the most important objective, which is to make Malaysia the regional automotive hub in EV. And number three, to promote increase in value-added activities in a sustainable manner. Number four, which is very important to us as well, in the context of balance of trade, in the context of trade, promote increase in exports of vehicles and automotive components. We have measures in NAP, in particular to promote the export of automotive components and to some extent exports of vehicles as well. Number five, to promote more Bumiputra participation in the total value chain. This is a very important national agenda of government. Number six, of course, consumers are very important by offering safer and better quality products at competitive prices. So these are six objectives of the NAP 14, but the most important objective is to make Malaysia the hub for EV, to make Malaysia the leader in this segment, to open up. As I said, at present, the 1.8 litre and below is closed. We have frozen the issue of manufacturing licenses for cars below 1.8. Now it's going to be open, but only to the EV sector. Okay, next technical definition of EV. We're going to give this to you in the next few minutes. They got to meet a set of defined specs in terms of carbon emission level and fuel consumption. So these are two very important components. One is fuel consumption, another is emission. These are the two main variables being used in deciding whether a particular technology or particular car fits into this definition of EV. It includes fuel efficient vehicles, hybrid, EV, alternative fuel, so all these things. Okay, and these are next the most specific definition of what EV is all about. There are seven segments there, from A, segment A, B, C, from micro car to the very big cars. So these are technical definitions. So micro car, the weight, curb weight has got to be less than 800 kg, and this car has got to travel at least 100 kilometers on 4.5 liters of petrol. So that's the definition. So city car, which is 1,800 to 1,000 cc in terms of weight, will be, sorry, in terms of weight will be 800 to 1,000 kg, and the car has got to travel 100 kilometers, at least 100 kilometers on 5 liters of fuel. So these are the definitions. As I said, we are giving this out to you. These are technical issues. These are of course, this definition is dynamic. Yeah, it will be revised every now and then, based on international best practices. Okay, next will be two-wheelers. There's EV spec for two-wheelers as well. Yeah, two-wheelers, correct? Two-wheelers. Huh? Okay, that will be motorbikes. Yeah, two-wheelers. I'm sorry, two-wheelers. That's a definition for motorbikes as well. Yeah. Okay, now I'm going to specific incentives given. Yeah, number one, customized incentives for both foreign and domestic investments. Yeah, the pioneer status, investment tax allowance, grants in the form of research and R&D and training, infrastructure facilitation, lower taxes, expat posts. These are expat posts. These are posts. Huh? These are not. These are expat posts. I'm going to detail on some of these issues later. Yeah, this is a summary. No investment conditions, yeah, no equity condition, no minimum number of vehicles you need to produce, no export condition, so there are no conditions attached. Yeah, yeah. So safety is got to comply with the vehicle type approval. Okay. A very important component of this policy is financial support going to be provided by the government of Malaysia. Yeah, this slide, next slide, is on financial support. We have consulted with EPU and the Treasury. This is 2014 to 2020. It's not this year or next year. It's over a period, and it's not going to be spent in 1 year. This is until 2020. So 2014, 15. So it's actually six years. 14, 15, 6 years altogether. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Is it 7 years altogether? Yeah, seven. 2014. So it's 7 years, over 7 years, about 2 billion altogether. Yeah. So we are going to provide soft loans. This is a very critical industry, tool, dies and molds, 765 million. Component, yeah, technology, 575. Issues related to competitiveness, 295. Infrastructure on distribution, 125. Developing EV infrastructure, 130. These are soft loans, is 1890. Yeah, over 7 years, between now and the year 2020. Grants, human capital development, Bumi Putra development, so that will be another 175. All in all, it's about over 2 billion. So this is a very important, so to ensure that this policy succeeds, it is very important to provide some help, and the government has decided that over the next few years, until 2020, we're going to provide more than 2 billion ringgit in the form of grants and soft loans. And all these are in respect of EV. All these incentives, all this money is going to the EV segment. Those of you who are interested to invest in this sector are entitled to receive loans and grants under this this policy. Okay? So these are funds, very important component of the policy. Next. Will be, I'll show you what our targets. Yeah, in any policy, you need to have some targets. At present, we have about 550,000 people involved in this sector, direct and indirect, manufacturing and aftermarket. And with this policy, we hope to be able to create 150,000 additional job opportunities. Yeah, in the next, this is until 2020, mind you, in the next 6-7 years. We hope to be able to generate an additional 150,000 job opportunities, 70,000 in manufacturing, and aftermarket 80,000. Exports, I must say, this is very modest. We're trying hard to push. Yeah, this year, or 2013, the export value was about 5 billion ringgit. We're going to double this to 10 billion. I must say this is a modest target. We're trying very hard to push this number even higher. Two times in terms of increase, but this is very small in the context of the capabilities of some of vendors. And then export recycled materials and remanufactured components, about 2 billion. Now, of course, there's none, but in consistent with this green policy, there will be, we expect to export about 2 billion in terms of recycled materials and remanufactured components. Okay. Next, in terms of production, now it's only, I mean, in terms of volume of production of passenger cars, last year is about 570,000 units. By 2020, 7 years from now, we hope to be able to hit 1.25 million units. So a doubling in terms of production in 6-7 years. Yeah, and total industry volume, from what is this? Should be the other one. Total industry TIV. Yeah, okay, 1 million in terms of TIV, and now it is 650,000 exports. 2013, we exported only about 20,000 at most vehicles in the last few years. We hope to be able. This is a very ambitious target. Yeah, 2020. This is 2020. We hope to be able to export 250,000 units of EV. Energy efficient vehicles, from about 20,000 to about 250,000 in the year 2020. Commercial vehicles, production last year was 55,000. 2020, we hope to be able to hit 100,000 units of commercial vehicles. Motorcycles are doubling in the production of motorcycles in the next 6-7 years. Okay, I'm repeating now what I said earlier, which is NAP 2014. Next slide, ambitions for Malaysia to be an EV hub in ASEAN, including the production of hybrids and electric vehicles. The exemption of excise duties and import duties for hybrids and EV will be extended for models that are assembled in Malaysia. Yeah, this is a change in policy. As you know, for the last, 4 years? We have given import duty and excise duty exemption for hybrid and electric cars. Yeah, going forward, this facility is going to be open only to those who've got a commitment to produce or to assemble the cars locally, and finally, of course, to produce the cars in this country. We've been bringing lots of CBUs in the country to encourage the use of energy efficient vehicles, electric and hybrid vehicles. This policy will be discontinued from now onwards. We are going to provide this exemption only to companies which are going to assemble the cars in this country. Okay. What's going to happen with this new policy? We believe there'll be a number of new business opportunities. In specialized design, engineering prototyping center. I'm now talking about EVs. Testing vehicle service provider for vehicle type approval, high precision and engineering industries, foundry and casting industries. We hope these things will happen in the next 4 or 5 years. Okay, next. Vendors, these are a very important component of the supply chain, and we want them to be globally competitive. At present, there's a few. There's a few vendors in Malaysia which are exporting throughout the world. Somewhere around 20 of them are exporting throughout the world, some big, some small. And we would like to increase the number. We also want to increase exports of auto components from Malaysia. 5 billion last year, and we want this to increase to at least 10 billion by the year 2020. So we want to develop world-class vendors. We want them to be regional, global and regional component manufacturers. And these are some targets we have. We want some to achieve level 5 vendor capability, some others level 4, and some level 3. So these are ballpark figures in terms of vendors which we hope will be globally competitive. Okay, car prices. This is a very topical issue. Okay, we have as speculated in the media, MITI has developed a car price reduction framework. It's a framework. This is a free market. Malaysia is not a socialist state. We do not set car prices. So what we can do is to set a framework. We cannot force car companies to reduce prices, yeah? But we believe through competition and in line with our manifesto, PRU 13, yeah? We remain committed to reduce prices 20 to 30% in the next 4 or 5 years, yeah? Gradual, we have given this undertaking, gradual car price reduction in the next 5 years, yeah? In Parliament, yeah, some members of Parliament have been hounding me, why are car prices still high? Yeah, we've been telling them it's not going to happen in one moment. It's going to happen within 5 years. So this is our commitment in our Barisan National Manifesto. Yeah, this CPR has got a number of measures. Yeah, but the main thing is opening up of the Malaysian auto market, liberalisation. You know, starting, of course, Proton was protected, enjoying 70% market share, 50%. Now somewhere around 25%, and over the years, it is a fact that Proton has been facing more intense competition. Yeah, more intense competition. So FTA, ASEAN, yeah, this is going to be a very important factor that will drive, that will make the market more competitive, and prices will come down. Yeah, over 5 years. Yeah, so this has created, liberalisation has created a more competitive environment. Prices, of course, have become more competitive, and industry players have played a very important role in ensuring that we create this more competitive environment in the auto sector. Okay, I'll come back to some other issues later, but I'm just sharing with you why it is not possible for us now, under present circumstances, to consider, yeah, to consider reviewing some of these taxes. Last year, we estimated to have collected 480 million in the form of import taxes. Because as I said, from ASEAN is zero, from many countries taxes are low, therefore tax and hybrid is zero, therefore taxes we collected in the form of import duties are small. You can see from 2012 with 755, it was only about 480 last year. This is the trend that we foresee will happen in the next few years as we sign more FTAs. As import duties come down, therefore the government will collect less and less from this sector of import taxes. Excise duties, this is contentious point being debated in the country. 2010, 5.2 billion, last year was 7.3 billion. Sales tax, which is 10% of the value, 1.6 billion in 2010 and 2 billion in 2013. You can see the auto sector is a very important contributor to the government's coffers, yeah, from 7.4 billion in 2010 to about 9.8 billion in 2013. And the biggest component, of course, is excise duties, yeah, comprising about 75%. 75% of duties collected from the auto sector comes from excise duties. Okay, on excise duties, yeah, the position of the government is as follows, that given the current situation of the budget, it is not possible for the government to review excise duties. But the government, of course, in the next few years, will review the fiscal situation, and as the fiscal situation improves, the government will consider looking into the possibility of gradually reducing excise duties. Okay, 2 points. Number one, at this present moment of time, it is not possible for the government to consider any reduction in excise duties, number one. Number two, going forward, the government will be monitoring its fiscal situation, and in the event the fiscal situation is conducive, the government is open to the possibility of gradually reviewing excise duties. As you know, excise duties are now between 65 and 105%, 65 to 105, although many car companies, through various policies, pay a lot less than that. We estimate car companies pay about 50%, although the nominal rate is 65 to 105, but in actual fact, because of various concessions given, the average tax rate paid by most companies is about 50%. So going forward, if the financial situation improves, then the government is open to the possibility of reducing excise duties gradually over a period of time. So this is an answer to many proposals coming from the public in Parliament, especially in a run-up to GE 13. Yeah? I hope that will put a closure or some closure to this contentious subject of excise duties. Okay. Next, having said all that, yeah, we are pleased to know, some of these numbers came out in today's reports in the media, that a number of companies, some of them are present in this room, have reduced their prices. Yeah, and 30%, and all this, what I have here on the screen, represents 30% of the total Malaysian car market. In other words, 30% of Malaysians who bought these cars last year have already been able to benefit from car price reduction. Yeah, we say gradual reduction, 20 to 30% over a period of 5 years. And in the first year, which is 2013, yeah, Saga Auto, Saga SV and Saga FLX, for example, the bosses are here, I hope the numbers are correct, there's been a 12% reduction in the price of Saga. Yeah, Persona as well, 13%. And this is, I mean, some have been telling me that some thrills have been taken away. That's not the case. Eh? Viva, Produa, the boss is here as well, 2,000 ringgit, 4%. Alza, there's another Alza which came later. Yeah, this is the previous Alza. Eh? The new Alza was Dato Amina is here, you might want to elaborate later on. This is 3%. Viva, Produa, Alza is 7%. Myvi, 3%. Nissan Sentra, 30%. Honda Jazz, 70%. So all these nine car makes, yeah, or nine or ten, or more, even a bit more than that, yeah, all these constitute about 30%. All these models here, yeah, constitute about 30% of the Malaysian market. That means 30% of Malaysians who bought these cars last year have enjoyed some price reduction. The price reduction ranged from 3 to 17%, depending on what car you buy. Of course, some people are not convinced, but this is a reality. Yeah, this is a fact that some car prices have come down, and this is consistent with our wish for car prices to come down. So as I say, yeah, 30% market share, and we've been informed that this year more new models and variants will be introduced. Yeah, and this price is going to be competitive. Yeah, for example, and we think. We think you combine those models in 2013 plus these new models, yeah, the market share of all those models whose prices might be reduced can come up to as much as 55%. So in other words, 55% of Malaysians will be able to enjoy some reduction in car prices ranging from 2, 3% to 17%. Yeah, if you begin from last year and the new models that are going to be introduced in the year 2014. So, you know, that's my brief summary of what's happening to car prices. 2 points. Number one, some companies have reduced car prices in view of greater competition. Yeah, nothing to do. The government, of course, we encourage them, but we're not forced. We cannot force them. This is a free market. We cannot force anyone in this country. Yeah, car prices are not subject to price control. It's not like RON 95 or RON 97. It's a free market. So this reduction in car prices have come about through greater competition in the industry. Okay. Next, AP. This is another hot subject. I must say, when we talk about NAP, there are two issues which the public are interested to know more about. Firstly, what's going to happen to car prices. Secondly, AP. I must admit that this is a difficult issue for the government of Malaysia, yeah? And the government in the next couple of weeks after Chinese New Year, we're going to appoint a body, yeah? It could be a consultant, it could be a body, to do a thorough study and to assess the impact on the termination or continuation, not just termination, or continuation of the AP policy on Bumiputera participation in the industry and also on the industry at large. So that's our decision. We deliberated on this very carefully. Given representations we get from every sector in Malaysia, not only the AP holders, but also consumers and industry players. Yeah, of course, when I see AP holders, they have a view. When I see OEM manufacturers, they have another view. So the government has given this undertaking. We're going to do an in-depth study. In-depth study, and after Chinese New Year, we're going to appoint this body or this company which is going to undertake this study. So for the moment, the AP policy remains. Yeah. which is termination 2015 until this study is completed. Okay. Next, this is probably my last slide. Yep, I've got my last slide. Yeah, I just want to share with you that although this EV, the NAP 2014, is just announced today, 20th of January 2014, as a matter of fact, we have so far attracted some investments in this segment. First, Honda, I was there last week to open the new plant, 50,000 capacity additional. And this is going to produce hybrid cars for Malaysia and for the region as well. This involves an investment in total of 1 billion ringgit for Honda. And Produa, capacity expansion. We've been informed that Produa is actively looking into the possibility of entering this segment as well. I'm not too sure that figure can be revealed or not, with a potential investment of 1.8 billion. Mazda, they have already, we have approved, we have already approved, Marani, we have already approved, Mazda's investment. Mazda is 300 million so far. This is 30,000 units for the region. And Mazda is, is exporting some of these cars to Thailand. So these are successes to date. Although the NAP 2014 is one day old, or 1 hour old, it's announced today. But before this, we have approved a number of investments. One is Honda, Produa, and Mazda Malaysia. And the objective of this policy is to attract more investments into the EV segment. So ladies and gentlemen, in summary, the NAP 14 is to open up the 1.8 liter and below. Before this, manufacturing licenses have been frozen for cars which are 1800cc and below. Now it's going to be opened up, but this is only for energy efficient vehicles, and they've got to meet the criteria set by government. Number two, we're doing this because we want Malaysia to be the hub for EV in the region. We want Malaysia to produce 1.25 million cars by the year 2020. About 250,000 of those cars will be exported. We believe that with this, there will be an additional employment opportunities of about 150,000 people. Once again, the auto industry is a very important sector to Malaysia. We have done the right thing in setting up Proton in 1983. Of course, along the way, we have learned a lot of things. But at present, the market is becoming more and more open. More open because of AFTA, because of ASEAN. Cars are coming to Malaysia duty-free. More open because we are also importing cars duty-free from Japan by the year 2016. So the market is more liberal now. There was a time when car companies have got to come to MITI for approval on the car prices before they set prices. That was to protect Proton those days, 2004. But that policy has been dismantled in 2004, and now it is market-driven, and we believe market forces will continue to make this segment competitive. And it is for that reason that we are optimistic that this new policy will enable Malaysia to once again regain our position as one of the most dynamic hubs for car manufacturing in ASEAN. So that's all I have, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for your indulgence. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.